They learn the truth about us. We're too dangerous to coexist with.
Mass panic continues worldwide in the wake of the so-called Eye in the Sky event.
So we were kind of struggling to figure out how to open the episode, and we ultimately asked Anna, our editor of this episode, we want a new opening. We're thinking maybe some kind of like montage of like from around the world events. Like, do you have any ideas? Gave her like a very vague set of notes, and she said, okay, let me work on it. And a few days later came back with this incredible montage.
Urging people to be calm but vigilant.
Yeah, it was an amazing proof of concept. She also did a lot of the voices of newscasters in it. And we wound up using her voice for some of it because it sounded better than some of the professional voice actors.
Mandatory curfews are in place in major urban areas across the U.S.
If you can dream up a solution, I want you to come down to Witchwood Manor and present your proposal.
Staircase Project is Jin's idea. When Wade comes to her and asks, is there a way to, in our lifetime, launch a ship that will ultimately reach 1% light speed, which is the speed that the Santi fleet is coming? And all the scientists he's grilled on this so far have been highly pessimistic.
If you want to launch a reconnaissance probe immediately, it's simply impossible.
He's incredibly confident that this war that's going to take place will be achieved in our favor. And his philosophy is very simple. It's extraordinary. He says if the enemy can do what they're able to do, then we should be able to do it too, because then it's not impossible. The Santi are real, and they have declared war on us. I plan on fighting back.
Thomas Wade is an enigma and someone who's kind of morally obscure. He is almost like this dark figure that you're not sure is a good guy or a bad guy. However, in a battle of wits, they are really a good match for each other. And so I think, despite the fact that she kind of hates him, there's also this weird, playful relationship that they form. And they do end up having to work together to figure things out.
So Jin comes up with an idea that would allow us to kind of leapfrog some of that and skip ahead by taking an idea from the past, from Stanislaw Ulam, I believe, originally.
It's a very creative notion, but it's totally untested, not to mention the cost. Trillions?
Stars, our destination, is attracting the attention of the world's wealthiest individuals.
It's a fundraiser for the war effort. Bake sale for billionaires.
The Stars Our Destination is a great science fiction book by Alfred Bester that has nothing to do with the project and the show, but it was a fun shout out. The war effort is going to be long and hard and multi-generational. And as with any war effort, it's going to be immensely expensive.
The richest men and women have acquired ownership rights over stars.
And it seems like sort of a silly thing at the beginning. It's like, you know, selling stars. How many people are going to buy one? Like, you know, and it's an enormous amount of money and seems like a complete waste of resources.
Imagine this one's you, and this one's me.
Jin's relationship with Will is critical. And so we asked our various Jin contenders to read with Alex Sharp. And I remember talking to Alex after this had been done, and we said, what do you think? And he said, well, for me, it's always been Jess. And when you watch them now performing on screen, it's like, well, of course, it had to be these two. They're so good together.
Thanks for dinner, guys.
Uh-huh. Jin and Auggie have a confrontation at the beach house.
Can't believe you're working for that fascist fuck again.
I know how he comes across, but he's trying, which is more than most people can say.
He's a murderer.
In watching that scene and writing it for those actors, I think it's always fun when you have an argument where you can understand both sides, where you understand why Jin wants to fight back against these aliens who are coming to invade our planet. And from Auggie's point of view, you know, they're not going to be here for 400 years. Everyone you know and love, their kids, their grandkids, their great-grandkids will be gone by that point. I'm not going to be complicit in the slaughter of any more humans. And as Auggie points out,
last time we gave the best physicists in the world insane resources, they gave us Hiroshima.
No, I'm not designing a weapon.
Not yet.
the family that you have is the family you choose. And even when they agree to disagree, it's these common grounds that keeps them going as a family, as a team, and supporting each other, even through really hard stuff.
Auggie, she wouldn't have come all the way down here if she didn't need you.
One of the things we love about Alex's portrayal of this character is you really believe that he's an intensely smart individual. You believe that he's a scientist. You also believe that he's kind of considers himself a bit of a failure. And the reason he thinks that this happened is because he just didn't have the brain power to achieve everything he wanted to.
If I had your knowledge or an ounce of your talent, I would give it to her on the spot.
I was really drawn to him because as a character, he has like a level of humility that I think is, you know, one can only really aspire to, which is perhaps why he doesn't have like such a competitive edge as other people might. But there's a perspective that he has, which is astronomically huge.
You don't know the man she's working for.
I know that she wouldn't do anything if it wasn't right. It's for the greater good, isn't it?
I know you can hear me if you want to.
I think what we established in the first five episodes is a woman whose faith in the righteousness of what she's doing is completely unshakable until it gets shaken. And she is enough of a scientist and a rational person to realize that this was a mistake.
I'm an old woman whose old beliefs have led us down this terrible path.
But she has enough of a belief in her own abilities and her own intelligence that there might be some last Hail Mary she can pull off to undo all of the chaos she has wrought.
I don't blame her, and I've said that to Dan and the boys. They've said something like, oh, look, what she did was so bad, and I think her intentions were good.
But I still have an idea or two left in me. And centuries from now, there may well be a fair fight, or no fight at all.